Hang on just a second.
Okay, sorry.
Good morning. I forgot to put my mic on, so welcome back. I hope this is the last time I have to say welcome back. Welcome back. No, it is just awesome to be back. I am so glad to be back here. I know Anna and me both are tired of taping. I sit up here and I preach to nobody. And, you know, I don't know if anybody laughs at my jokes or not. And, you know, it's just, of course, today, you know, I found this out when I was at Baker's Chapel. I found out that, I found out that when I was at Baker's Chapel, I'd say something funny. Nobody laughed. Well, I realized I can't see them. Probably nobody laughed anyway, but that's beside the point because normally my jokes are stupid. But it is good to be back with you. It is really a pleasure to be able to worship together again. Wanted to just a couple things, which y'all already figured out. I'm sure you figured out there's not any hymnals in the pews. That's so you won't get them and lick them and then have somebody else get that. The words will be on the screen, obviously. And y'all know the mask mandate. I don't have to. Oh, hush. we're mandated kind of like the other, basically like their businesses. Now, Michelle and I were at Walmart yesterday and saw several people who took them off when they got in. You know, they passed through the people checking and then they took them off. But we're going to be better than them. I thank y'all all for wearing masks today. Are there any other announcements that anybody has to share this morning that we need to lift up? Well, let us get into this worship service as it should be with prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and this ability, or this ability to be here together and worship together again. Lord, for those who are watching, we pray for them as well, and that your Holy Spirit come upon them and us as we all join together either virtually or in the same building. Father, we praise your name and ask that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit and guide us in this worship. As in Jesus' holy and precious name we pray. Amen. All right, if you will please stand for our call to worship. Come and worship, everyone on earth, everywhere the sun shines.
Let us praise God together.
Christ calls us to come to worship, to rest from the things that are troubling us, to learn what Christ can teach us, and to realize what we can offer to others.
So that we can return into the world to serve, let us worship God together.
So our opening hymn is Over a Thousand Tongues. A lot of you might have this memorized, but even though you don't have your books, the words are right up there. And I would like to say that if you do not have a medical condition preventing you from doing so, if you keep your mask on while you're singing so we can try to follow the rules as best as possible. It might sound a little funny since I'm not wearing a mask, but I am quite far from you. So we're going to try to carry on as normal this morning. So we're going to do verses 1, 3, and 5.
Now we come to that point in our service where we share prayer concerns and also our celebration. So let's start with our concerns. Don't forget, if you have a name or names or something that you would like to be placed in the bulletin, it's on the third page in the bulletin, prayer request, and you want it in the bulletin, please put it on our prayer request card, and on your way out, place it in the offering plate. Which is another thing I forgot to say. If you did not notice, we will not come by with an offering plate this today. The offering plate is in the back, so if you'd like to place an offering, please do so when you leave, if you haven't already. But anyway, if you want somebody's name in the bulletin, write it on your prayer request card and place it in the offering plate on your way out. Are there any names that you'd like to lift up? Say Linda Seeley?
Linda Seeley. She's in our prayer
list. Okay. Okay. All right. Let's not forget Mike. Mike has gone to Senatobia. To was it Centovia Nursing Home or
memory care?
Yeah, this sharing names it's going to be a little harder since I can't hear you now. But okay, Mike. Okay, let's not forget Mike. Anybody else? Jessica Smith, your daughter-in-law, had a stroke. Let's pray for Jessica, okay? Anybody else?
Pray for Pam.
Pray for Pam? Yes, let's do that. Pam and Mike. Anybody else? All right, what about Joyce? We're back today, and there's got to be somebody that's got something. We might be in a pandemic. There may be things going on, but I know that you can find something to be thankful for today. Give me a joy, somebody.
Sunshine.
Sunshine.
Back at church.
Back at church.
I have one.
Yes.
So, you guys may or may not have noticed, but over the last little while, our organ, not our organist, but our organ, has been having some trouble, and because of money that was given in memory of Margaret Crook, we're going to be able to fully repair our organ and make it the way that it was meant to be. And I'm so thankful that we can sort of continue Margaret's memory in this church with the beautiful music that will be coming from our instruments. I'm joyful.
Will we get a recital from Joe?
Will we get a recital from Joe?
What is repeat?
Yes. Sure.
I'll do one if they want me to.
You can come up and he'll play just all day for you.
Okay. He can play.
Sing all night.
He can play.
Okay.
Yeah, we have one of Joe's students is going to play for us today.
Yes, that's right.
Going to be joyful.
It's a joy to have y'all. Anybody else? Come on, Baker's Chapel had a lot more joys than y'all. Come on.
It's not a competition.
Yeah, it is.
I'm back.
You're back. Ronnie's back. Yay!
I've been worried about him.
Yeah, well, he worries about you too. Anybody else? I'm glad I got a joy. Glad I got Sarah in front of me instead of behind me. It's a lot easier to keep my eye on her, which is. Anybody else? Joy and a prayer request. Anybody else? Let's prepare our hearts for prayer then.
Thank you.
Father above, we come to you. We lift up these names that were lifted up. We lift up the names that are on our hearts. We lift up people who maybe we forgot or whom we don't even know. Father, we lift up the rest of our church family that may not be here today. For those who are afraid, we lift up those who are dealing with the COVID-19, those who are on ventilators, those families who can't go into the hospital. We pray for those who are dealing with this pandemic in a financial sense, who are laid off or cannot work for whatever reason. We pray for those who are grieving, maybe because of the pandemic, but also because of other things. There are things going on in our lives each and every day that are painful to deal with. And Lord, we pray for those who are grieving. Pray for those who are depressed right now. Ask that you would heal. That you would heal physically, mentally, emotionally. Lord, we just pray that your hand be upon each person today. Lord, we pray for our world that's in turmoil. We pray for our leaders, our president, our governors, or our governor, our foes in the Senate. And just, Lord, we pray that they will make good decisions that will bring about peace. Father, we pray for all of those who are in harm's way. We pray for unrest, that you would be with all of those who are in danger because of it. Father, we just lift up those who are hurting, maybe those who are afraid, those who are protesting, those who are our enemies, those who hate us, those who love us. Father, we thank you. Thank you for such a wonderful day that we could come and be together with you and with each other. Thank you for the ability, for those who are with us virtually, that they can be with us, that we have these abilities. Thank you for all the good and great and wonderful things you do in our lives, that you've done, you are doing, or that you will do. We thank you. We thank you most of all for your son, Jesus, who came into this world to die for our sins, to rise, to defeat death, to promise to come back as well, and also who taught us how to pray. And we come together and lift up our voices in saying that prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I'm not singing again, don't worry. Our second hymn is Sweet Hour of Prayer. We're going to do verses 1 and 3. You can remain seated.
Thank you.
playing for us this morning, and his information, his name, and what he's going to be playing will be up above after our offertory prayer.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for all the gifts that you give us. Today, as we give back, we just pray a blessing over what is given and pray that you will use it to the betterment of your kingdom. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Get better every time you come up here. Thank you.
I can
play
next
time. Let's pray. Father, your word says not to be anxious, but sometimes, maybe every time I come before you, before the congregation to share your word, I am sort of anxious because I know I'm not worthy. But Father, I pray that you will speak. Use me or work in spite of me, but may each and every one of us hear what it is you want us to hear. May this day, this time, be about you. May we find glory in the reading and the preaching of your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before we stopped meeting, we started a sermon series on the Sermon on the Mount. I've been going through it online. It's been on YouTube. And, of course, today with Facebook Live, it will be continued to be online and on YouTube a little bit later. But we've been going through chapters 5, 6, and 7 of the Gospel of Matthew. We've been through 5, and we are in chapter 6. Actually, we're in a particular part of chapter 6, that is where Jesus teaches us how to pray. We call it the Lord's Prayer. We just prayed it a few minutes ago. What we need to know about this prayer is that it's been being recited since the early church in the first century. And in the first century, the church taught Christians to recite this prayer three times a day. So three times a day, they would not necessarily get together, but each person would pray the prayer, just as you know we know it. But we need to remember that these are not magical words. And it's okay to pray them every week. It's okay to pray them, to say them whenever. It's a good thing, actually. But we need to remember that these are words that teach us how to pray. They give us the ideals of what to say when we pray or how to pray. The possible problem that we find with saying the Lord's Prayer every week, because you have this memorized, many of you do, you got it memorized, you can say it in your sleep. I said the same thing when I preached on the affirmation of faith on the Apostles' Creed. The possible problem we can have is that it becomes rote. In other words, you say the words, but you just say them out of memory. You know, out of your brain, they just come out. And we don't realize what we're saying. So what we're going to do today, we're going to look at and realize what Jesus is telling us when we pray this wonderful prayer. All right? Well, we come to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6. We're going to begin with verse 7, 7 through 15. Hear the Word of God this morning. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them. For your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. Pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debt. We say trespasses, we'll talk about that in a minute. But forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. The Word of God for the people of God this morning.
Thanks be to God.
We're going to learn this very first line or part is, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, how we, our Father which art in heaven, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, that's how we say it. But I want to look at two things within this first part. One is the word Father and what the other is the word hallowed. Father. Father, the actual technical word is Abba, something that Jesus uses in a prayer later. And it's what, say, a child might say when he's talking to his dad, to his father, okay? It's a personal way of speaking. Now, this would be different for most of the Jews of this time. The Jews typically didn't see God in a personal, relational, father-type figure. They saw him as a great God, an awesome and holy God, which was so much different than them that they couldn't relate as much as they did to their earthly parents, okay? As a matter of fact, it was thought that if you could look upon the face of God, you'd surely die because he was so holy and we were so sinful. So what Jesus is saying is this is a personal way of reacting and talking to God. Now, why Father? Why do we say Father? As a matter of fact, God is most likely genderless, you know, not male nor female, so why Father? Well, I'll just go ahead and say the very first reason is because Jesus calls him Father. So therefore, we should call him Father. But let me tell you something that I was taught in seminary, because I want to share a little bit more. But what I was taught in seminary, which was a very liberal idea, and when I say liberal, I have nothing to do with politics. It's taking the words of the Bible and making them, you know, stretching them to be more liberally thought of and making them say something that they're not really meant to say. Well, I had several professors, most of them actually in seminary, back when I was in seminary about 20 years ago. Okay, there was this thing that they had all decided that we could call God Father. We couldn't use masculine pronouns. So the very first paper I had, I would call God Father, or excuse me, I will call God He. It was circled in red every time, and it was stated on that paper that the next time I did that, he would take off for me saying that. I could call God Mother, by the way. I could call Him She, but I couldn't call Him Father or He. Now, why is this? Now, this was their explanation. Because many people have fathers who are very much less than perfect. A lot of people have fathers who maybe beat them or who abuse them in many sorts of ways, okay? So when I call God Father, refer to Him as He, it may put an ugly picture in their mind. Let's go back to the great reformer, Martin Luther. Martin Luther was one of the great theologians during the Reformation time. And he saw God as a vengeful God. Why? Because his dad beat him on a regular basis. So he just associated that with God as Father. Of course, thankfully, because we have a lot of our thoughts based upon what he taught, thankfully he realized later that God was God of grace and not a punishing God. So it was stated, I'm getting to my point here, it was stated that many people will see God as a father is a poor figure, is a bad figure. But the problem with that is that we're not teaching that God is the perfect Father. And that's what we need to know today. God may be generous, but He's like the stereotypical father and mother, okay? The stereotypical in a perfect world, the father would be the disciplinarian and the protector, the strong one. The mother is the one who cares for and is very loving, who takes care of a child's boo-boos, you might say. And so you take all of that together, and that is God. But Jesus says you need to call Him Father, Abba, because it's like talking to your dad. So it's a very personal thing. It's a very personal thing. And instead of, and I don't know what your parents were like. I had a good dad, thankfully, but he was far from perfect, and he'll say that. And you may have had wonderful dads, or you may have had dads that you know, were much less than wonderful. But no matter what your dad was like, remember, that's not the ultimate father. Those dads who are good get their perfect attributes from God as Father. So let us remember this personal relationship with us and God as Father. That's why Jesus says, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed. Hallowed means holy, okay? Hallowed means that God is holy. And so there's some sense that we must be reverent. Now, what I mean by this is that though God is personal, we got to remember who is who in this relationship, okay? We're not to try to bend His will to ours, but we're about bending our will to His, because He is the perfect Father, and He does know best. He knows what's right. So, holy are you. Now, this doesn't mean we can't be jovial with Him. It doesn't mean we can't laugh with Him. It doesn't mean that we can't, you know, rant and stuff because we got to be so reverent. But again, we remember who's who in the relationship. It also doesn't mean we can't be selfish in our prayers. You know, a lot of people think, well, I can't be selfish. I'm a selfish person. I can't be selfish in my prayers. You know what the book of James says? Book of James says, you don't have because you haven't asked. It's okay to pray selfishly. I use the illustration of a kid in a candy store. The kid goes to the candy store and says, oh, Dad, I want this, I want this. The father may say, okay, you've been a good boy, so you get it. He also may say, no, it'll ruin your dinner, so you're not going to get it. So the thing about it is, we can pray. I can pray, hey, God, I really want a new truck. Will you help me get the finances for it? But I got to remember, if He says no, He is still the perfect Father, the one I need to be reverent, but also loving, have this personal relationship with. So God is a perfect Father. His name is hallowed. He is holy. We are to be reverent, but also have a wonderful relationship just like we would with a good dad. All right. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Here comes the tough time. The tough words. I started to think of earlier that you save the worst for last. Well, actually, I'm saving the worst for the middle. It's not really the worst, but it's the hardest. I don't know that many people realize what they're praying for when they say, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Oh, you might think, well, that's wonderful. Your will be done here on earth. Heaven's perfect. Let's make God, let's make the world perfect. But do you really, do we really want God's will to be done here on earth? You know what it means? It means that you and I have to change. It means we have to change if God's will is going to be done here. Now, I've been told when I go to churches, I've been told by pastors, said, don't ever try to change anything in the first year. They'll get mad at you. Because change is an ugly word in the church, let me tell you. So, you know, it means we have to change. And people who are not Christians, they're not necessarily going to pray this prayer. So we're not going to talk about them. We're going to talk about us in the church. Okay? I'm talking about just the folks in the church. If we pray this and mean it, what would the church, just the church, and not Pleasant Hill, but the church in general, what would the church look like if we really meant and it actually came to pass, your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven? Well, first of all, we would welcome. Welcome any person. It wouldn't matter their color. It wouldn't matter their religion. It wouldn't matter their sexual orientation. It wouldn't matter how many tattoos, ear piercings, color of their hair. It wouldn't matter if they got shorts on or suit. It wouldn't matter if, and y'all probably think, well, hey, we're a welcoming church. That's great. Wouldn't matter if they're ex-cons. Yeah, that's okay. They've done their job, or they've done their time. It wouldn't matter if the reason they're ex-cons is because they murdered somebody. It wouldn't matter if they still do drugs. Here you go. It wouldn't matter if they were child molesters. You go, oh, Greg, you're going too far there. You're going too far there. If God's will were to be done on earth as it is in heaven, where do you think the best place for somebody who has problems in their life or has done something horrible to be than in worship? By the way, God's will, not Greg's will, so don't shoot the messenger. If God's will were to be done, everybody would be welcome within our worship, but also not just worship, they'd be welcome within our lives. We would welcome people. Let me ask you this. Just think about this. Is there anybody in this congregation? Are there people you don't even know their name? We're a small congregation. We should know everybody. What if God's will were to be done here on earth? We would get to know each other. It wouldn't just be within church. Everybody would be a part of everybody's lives in some form or fashion. If God's will were to be done on earth, as in heaven, just within the church. Let me tell you something else. Worship, when we come to worship, it would be about Jesus. Y'all share that. Say that name with me. Jesus. Worship would be about Jesus. It wouldn't be about how wonderful, which it is wonderful, banana sings. It wouldn't be about whether you like the preacher or not. It wouldn't be about whether we have an organ or piano or we got a band. It wouldn't be about praise music or traditional music. It wouldn't be about if we got bells and whistles or, you know, if we praise or raise our hands. It wouldn't have anything to do with those things. But people oftentimes choose a church on what they like best. Instead, if God's will were to be done, it would all be about Jesus. We'd come to seek Jesus, and then all the rest would just be extra. It wouldn't matter as long as we could praise and worship and love Jesus. If God's will were to be done. If God's will were to be done, we'd all be, and it'd be us up here, would be bringing you closer, doing our best to bring everybody closer to Jesus as well. It wouldn't be just about going through the motions. Worship would be about Jesus. Life would be about Jesus. There'd be no politics. Now, again, I say in the church, I'm not talking about elections. I'm not talking about presidential or governor candidates or anything like that. I'm talking about within the church at all. Nobody in here can deny that there's not politics within the church. There's politics in every single church. Somebody, at some point, has tried to get somebody else on their side. Somebody at some point in many churches have tried to get rid of the pastor. Somebody at some point has tried to get somebody to help them make the piano player play faster or slower or better. Not Iris, because she's perfect, okay? Or just, what I'm saying is there's politics going on in churches, and it's all about people calling others and trying to get people on their side. That's really what politics is. If God's will were being done, there'd be no more politics in church. Why? Because church would be about who?
Jesus.
I like that word. Jesus. We'd all be people of integrity. That's pretty easy. We say, we do what we say and be who we claim to be. We'd all have integrity. Church would be less about self and more about others. Church, okay, money would be used in ministry more than it would be used within the church. Now, I know, as a church, we've got to pay bills. You know, there are bills we got to pay. But you know what? If I haven't gotten you mad at me yet, I'm about to make you mad. If Pleasant Hill had to close the doors, church would continue going on. Y'all know that? Nobody wants that, by the way. I don't want that. Okay, so don't even go there. But what I'm getting at is what's more important is about the kingdom than about any church. Whether it's this church or the biggest church or the smallest church or whatever congregation. We fall in love with our congregations, and I love this congregation. But we fall in love with the congregation with the church building so much that we forget that church is really more about outside than inside. If God's will were being done on earth, it would be about outside. But not only that, if God's will were being done on earth, you know what? The people of the community, we wouldn't need governmental programs. We wouldn't need welfare. We wouldn't need disability and stuff like that. Why? Because we would take what we have and share with others and take care of others. I'm getting stepping on toes again. Because people like what they have. I like what I have. But what I'm getting at is we would be a community. We would all love each other. And not just claim it or say it, but act it out. If God's will, not Greg's will, if God's will were being done on earth as it is in heaven. I've already said this, but I'm going to say it again. We'd all think about who?
Jesus.
Well, that's it. If God's will were being done on earth, every day of our lives, we would think about Jesus. God's will. Okay. Like I said, some of these things you've just heard, things that are hard to swallow, because it means change. But each and every one of us could use some change. And I'm the first one to admit it. I need change every day. I need a lot of change. I need to pray, God, your will be done in me here as it will be when I get to heaven. See, because this life is not about just getting to heaven. It's about bringing heaven to us. It's about bringing heaven here. That's what Jesus talks about when he talks about the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. Perfect. Perfect. Now that I got through the hard part, let's go on. This is the part I call the give us, forgive us, and lead us prayer. Part of the prayer. This is the last part. It says, give us this day our daily bread. All right, let's just stop there. Give us this day our daily bread. Daily, meaning one day. Bread, which means, food, but it could mean necessities. It could mean electricity. It could mean transportation. It could mean, whatever. Give us this day our daily bread. Now, let's go back to the Old Testament, okay? Go back to the Old Testament and go back to Moses and the Israelites. Maybe you remember the story. They were in the wilderness and they got hungry. They didn't have McDonald's nearby. So they called upon God. They yelled to God, why did you bring us out here? We're starving. So God told Moses, he told him to tell them, I'm going to send you food. It's going to be manna from heaven. Y'all remember that word, manna? Manna from heaven. Now, manna was evidently some kind of small wafer that was bread and it was sweet at the same time. In other words, you got your supper and your dessert all in one. So they gave them manna, or God gave them manna, But they were only to save enough for one day, daily. If you save, well, unless the next day was the Sabbath, you know. But you're only supposed to save enough for one day. Now, if you save more than enough for one day, if you tried to, you know, hoard or try to save up enough in case God forgot to send it the next day, it would ruin. There'd be maggots on it, okay? It'd be that bad. What was God telling them? Rely on me, be dependent on me each and every day. When we ask for our daily bread to be given, give us this day our daily bread, he's saying, every day, call upon me for your needs. When we pray for our needs to be met. And forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. Now, we say, forgive us our trespasses. We forgive those who trespass against us. Some say, forgive us our sins. That's a good one. Good way of putting it. As we forgive those who sin against us. All of these words are basically accurate. But debt is probably the most accurate, okay? Because the word literally means something that we owe, okay? So we owe God a great debt. We owe him the debt because we sinned and we're imperfect. So we owe him this debt, and we ask you to forgive our debt to you because of our sin, as we have, it assumes we are forgiving others, as we have forgiven others. Now go to Matthew 18 to remind you of a parable of the unforgiving servant. And I won't go into detail about it, but let me just share with you real quickly what it means or what it says. This servant comes to the king, before the king. He owes a great debt, more than he could ever pay in many lifetimes. And the king, you know, is going to sell him off, but he begs for mercy. And the king says, okay, I'm going to put you on an installment plan. No, he doesn't do that. He doesn't give him an installment plan. He doesn't say you can pay part of it back. He forgives it completely. Just like our God, our Father, forgives us when we ask him to have mercy, when we ask him to forgive us of our sins. But what happens is this guy goes and finds another servant who owes him a little bit, and he says when the guy can't, you know, pay him back, he throws him in debtor's jail, debtor's prison. And so the king says, look, I forgave you all this. You can't forgive a little bit? I've done so much for you, and you can't even have a little compassion on a fellow person, fellow servant? I'm going to throw you in prison where you'll be beaten forever and ever. This is the only, evidently Jesus thought a lot about this particular part, because this is the only part of the prayer that he elaborates. In verse 14, he says, for if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Okay, if I forgive others, God's going to forgive me. Yay. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive yours. So if we refuse to forgive others, God's not going to forgive us. Because he's done so much for us, he expects us to do the same for others. Now, there are many things we can forgive, many things, you know, that are forgivable, many things that are easy or maybe hard, but we can accomplish it. I'm going to tell you this. There are some things in life when somebody does something so bad, you cannot forgive them. But the Bible says with God, all things are possible. In other words, what I'm saying is under my own strength, I can't forgive. So I need God's help. I need the help of Jesus. It may not happen overnight, but when we ask Jesus, when we go to Jesus, begging him to help us forgive, when we are willing to forgive, I think that's what God wants. Because ultimately, it will happen. Because with God, all things are possible. I've heard of people who have forgiven horrible, horrible deeds against them. Maybe you have. Or maybe you're holding that grudge right now. Jesus says, this is where Gordon Gregg now, but I think he means if you're unwilling to forgive, your Father's not going to forgive you. All right. He says, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Lead us not to I had somebody once tell me, why does Jesus ask or tell us to ask God not to lead us into temptation? Doesn't that go against his nature? He's not going to lead us into temptation, is he? Well, what we got to do is we got to read this as a whole. Lead us not to where we're going in our sinful ways. Lead us not into that temptation, but deliver us from it. Instead, deliver, lead us not to the place we're going, but deliver us from the places we might wind up. In other words, help us not to sin. Save us from evil, or some translations say the evil one. So save us from those temptations that are leading us astray. Okay, so that's the prayer. Father, personal, hallowed, reverent, your kingdom come, change us, make us be the way you want us to be. Give us what we need every day. Forgive us. Help us forgive, make sure we forgive others. Lead us not where we shouldn't go, but instead deliver us from that who's leading us that way. Now, the first or second century, the church decided this ends too abruptly, so they added, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." Amen. And some people say, "The kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever." Okay? Whichever you say, that's fine. But this wasn't in, as you can tell, in the original prayer. But it was saying, is a way of ending it, saying, "Okay, God, you are powerful, you are glorified. Amen." You know, you got to say amen after every prayer, right? Well, maybe not. You can pray anyway. Any way you want to. You don't. These aren't magical words. Remember that. You can pray any way you want to. You can pray in the car if you want to. Just please don't shut your eyes. You can talk to God. You can praise him. You can come to the altar. You can kneel. God just wants to hear from you. Prayer is about conversation. But this is an outline of things. Not every single prayer has to have every single aspect, but we need to pray for all these topics, at least from time to time. Okay? So when you pray the Lord's Prayer, remember. Remember what you're praying so that it's not just, you know, words that come out. And even if you don't remember the Lord, or don't pray the Lord's Prayer, remember the kinds of things that Jesus wants from you to pray for. That's why he teaches us how to pray. Amen?
So a few things before our closing prayer. First off, we do not have a sending forth this morning, so once our closing prayer is over and the benediction is said, our ushers will help dismiss us so we don't get too bunched up at the exits. You can go out this door or that door, whichever one. And the second thing is a little bit harder to share, so I wrote it down. So these past months have been different than any of us thought that they were going to be, right? I'm sure that nobody expected us to be meeting in church this way, covered up. And it's caused us all to have to learn different ways to follow the paths that were made for us. In the last couple of weeks, I've gotten my master's degree in education, and I've started applying for associate adjunct professor jobs at some area community colleges. I want to be Dr. Fortenberry one day, and this is the step in that direction. My husband, Corey, is also going to be going back to school full-time to finish his degree. Now that I've gotten all this to the school, it's his turn. And it's all been a little chaotic, and tomorrow I'll be back in school with kids who haven't been inside a classroom since March. So it's going to be like I'm a first year teacher again. And after a lot of thought and prayer, I have decided to step down as the worship director here at Pleasant Hill at the end of August. And it has been an absolute joy and blessing to worship with all of you every Sunday for like the past 3 years now. It's been quite a while. But it's a real time of transition for me and my family, and I feel like I'm supposed to clear my plate for whatever comes next. Sometimes God calls us to move forward even when he hasn't illuminated the next step yet. And I feel like that is what's happening now in my life. I know that God is going to continue to take care of this congregation and of all of you individually, just like he always has. I've been so proud of this church over the last years that I've been here. We went from having two services, and it was a different sort of structure, and you all have adapted amazingly, as Christians are almost always called to do. And I want you guys to know this is not something I decided lightly, but I'll have the next few Sundays with you all, thankfully, in person instead of online, so I actually get to see some of your faces in the last couple of weeks, but I wanted to let you all know, and I hope that you will continue to pray for me as I continue to pray for you. So, with that all being said, let's stand and sing our closing hymn this morning.
Wait for them to dismiss you, and you can go to the back or the back or the front, whichever. May God bless you. May He bless you today. May He keep you. May He share with you so many gifts, so many things today. His grace, His glory, may we all receive it all. And when we go out, may we share everything we've received with everybody we meet. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.